Thanks for joining us for today's transportation seminar, which is sponsored by O-Track. I'm one of your co-hosts, Leming Wang. I'm a faculty member at Urban Study and Planning, other hosts for this quarter's transportation seminar, including Kelly Clifton, Professor Kelly Clifton, and Jenny Liu. Today we're very pleased to have our guest speaker, Junfeng Jiao, assistant professor from Ball State University. He will talk to us about a combination of two very fascinating topics, food and accessibility. Okay, food, healthy food for sure. And I'm very impressed that he's making the trip among other things, with a twisted foot. So probably will give him a very unique perspective of accessibility, I guess. So without further ado, I will transfer the floor to Dr. Jiao.
Thank you very much, Vivi, for the introduction.
As you can see, I'm currently disabled, but I tested the ADA design at Ball State. So far, good. You guys did a very good job for disabled people. We can move around.
Can't hear you.
Oh, okay. I just said Portland State University had a very good ADA design. So although I twist my ankle, and I can still easily move around. So far, so good, my experience. So today, I'm very happy to present one of my previous research. It's called Food Desert and Healthy Food Accessibility. Just want to check, can you hear me on the back? Okay. Okay, I try my best. So as Li Ming said, I'm an assistant professor at Ball State University. This research is done in Seattle. It's funded by NIH, National Institute of Health. So let's talk about the healthy food accessibility and the food desert in Seattle, our nearby cities. So background, access to healthy food and existing food desert has become important policy issues in urban planning field. Limited access to healthy food or living in the food desert can lead to poor diet control or high level obesity or other diet related diseases. So we all know what is good food and healthy food. I just give you some pictures. Like Whole Food is supposed to sell very good food. And we call it a nutrition rich food source. Some fast food, McDonald's, Taco Bell, they're supposed to sell some high calorie, no nutrition food. Also, we have some corner grocery stores. They're supposed to sell some high cost and canned food, most likely. So, as I said, supermarket generally offer a variety of healthy food at a reasonable cost. Healthy food access, according to USDA, is defined by proximity to a supermarket or large grocery stores. The term food desert, originally coined by a UK researchers, it describes two things: low-income neighborhood, both urban and rural, that has a limited access to full-service supermarket or grocery store. Here we talk about two things: low income, limited access. If you're high income, living far, far away, you can even use a helicopter to buy some fresh food. But if you're low income, you even live next to Whole Food or supermarkets, you cannot go there because you're low income. You cannot afford that. This is a picture about access to supermarket. It's saying no car, no supermarket within a mile. It's created by USDA. So you can see Northwest, Portland and Seattle in a pretty good shape. So we're not that dark shaded color, so we're light. So we have a, that means we have relatively good access to healthy food, or at least to supermarkets. This is a definition by USDA food deserts. So you can see, again, these two maps have some low overlap, but have some difference. These are county boundaries. So this is, by US definition, USDA definition, the location of food desert. In the following, I will give a specified research on how to identify food desert and food access in Seattle, Washington. Again, USDA defines food desert as low income. We mentioned that, a census tract where most of the people have low access to supermarket. Again, income and accessibility. To qualify low income, you need to be a poverty line 20% or higher, or a median family income below 80% of the area's median family income. What is a low access? At least 500 people, or at least 33% of the census tract population lived 1 mile from a supermarket or grocery stores. So this is a USDA definition. Of course, there's a lot of literature review on other definitions by carried out by individual researchers. To summarize them, I will give you some problem of existing research. The unit of analysis is usually very big. Zip code, census tract, or 1 by 1 mile grid. Or sometimes they use a block group. Very few use block. We all know the definition about a block, block group, census tract, zip code, right? Again, physical access to food source or measure the straight line distance, they assume we can fly. We can fly from our home to the destination. Not so many use a network distance to measure accessibility. Also, previous research assumed we all drive to grocery stores. Although it's partially true, but there are definitely some people use public transportation, working, or other transportation mode to get food. Last thing, they all assume, or I can say they all assume, food are same price within different grocery stores. Winkles, they assume, sell price at the same price at Whole Foods. We all know that's just not true, right? So from this, you can see the existing problem. So my research is trying to develop an improved method to identify food desert and refine measure to supermarkets. To improve their definition, their method. This is the conceptual framework of my research. So because food desert is defined by two criteria, low income and accessibility. So in my research, I borrowed all the existing definition of low income from here. You either have more than 20% of below poverty, more than 40% below double poverty, and less than 80% below median house income, and so on. These are all quoted from previous research. This is my contribution. Accessibility, how to measure access to healthy food. We measure two access, physical access, by consideration different transportation mode. You either walk, bike, bus, drive. Baseline measure is defined by USDA. They say, if you live 1 mile away from supermarket and you are low income, you are by definition living in food desert. So we have also borrowed USDA definition of food desert. My second contribution is I considered food cost within different supermarkets. We all know they are not at the same price, so we need to consider that. To tell you that, I live by the Whole Foods when I was a student at the University of Washington, but I never come to that store to buy groceries because I cannot afford that. Simple is that, we need to consider economic accessibility. Research data. This research was funded by NIH, National Health Institute. We got the social demographic data and the street network from US 2000 sensor. And we get a street network from S3 street map package. We carried out a survey about 207 and 7 unique supermarkets in Seattle area, which are provided by Public Health Department of Seattle and King County. This is all the major data source used in this research. For some of you who haven't been to Seattle, this is the Seattle and King County map. The dark shaded area, city of Seattle boundary. The light shaded areas is King County urban growth boundary. And this is Lake Washington, the Puget Sound. So you can see the distribution of supermarket. They are roughly evenly distributed. Because we want to measure economic access, we want to measure their cost in different grocery stores. So the research team carried out a market basket survey. We collected the food cost across 207 supermarkets and classified them into three categories: high cost grocery store, medium cost grocery store, and low cost grocery store. You must be wondering how we classify this food. So basically, we have a food market basket, include 100 common user food source. Then we go to different stores and market their price. Then we get an average of these 100 different food. Then use that information, we classify the supermarket in the three different categories. So this is a breakdown of supermarket classification. We have a low cost, Fred Meyer, Winco, Costco, Walmart, Cash and Carry, Albertson. And we have medium cost, Safeway, QFC, Quality Food Center, Trader Joe's. And we have high cost grocery store, the Puget Sound Consumer Co-op, Metropolitan Area, and Whole Food. This is a breakdown of different supermarkets by their food cost. Okay, this is a new distribution of different grocery stores within King County. The red dot are the high cost grocery stores. You can see almost all of them are located northern part of city. Only one located near the southern part, by near the water area. So you can see the distribution of the different grocery stores. But for the low and the median cost, they're roughly evenly distributed spatially. How do we measure physical access? We talk about how to measure economic access by categorizing into different categories. In order to measure physical access, we generate a service areas around each supermarket based on so the population living within that service area, we think they can get access to that supermarket. So individuals living within the service areas had access to supermarket. And again, we define the service area by different transportation mode and the travel time. We have five different service areas. The first one is just a 1 mile network distance from supermarket to just buffer out. So this is a USDA definition about food accessibility. And we have 10 minutes walking, 10 minutes biking, 10 minutes bus, and 10 minutes driving. So we have five different service areas. So give you some example. Say we have a Whole Food store here. We generate 10 minutes walking service areas, which is a diamond shaped buffer. We also generate a 1 mile baseline measure, which is from this point to this point is 1 mile. From this point to this point is 1 mile. And we generated 10 minutes biking, 10 minutes bus, 10 minutes driving service areas. So you can see when we switch to the transportation mode, the service area is getting larger and larger. So because we have a physical access and economic access, so we have a matrix here. So we have five different physical accessibility measurements, and we have three different economic measurements. So we have basically 20 service areas. So to give you more example, how they look like. So the first one is low-cost supermarket. The dark shaded area, the black areas urban, is King County Urban Growth Boundary. And the small white areas, 10 minutes walking from low-cost supermarket. Then we switch to baseline measure, and we switch to transit measure. Then we switch to the driving. This is low cost. For the high cost, you can see same trend. When we switch the different transportation mode, the service area is getting larger and larger. So we know now how to measure physical size and economic size. But in order to define food desert, we need to quantify the vulnerable populations. As I mentioned before, we borrowed the previous definition about the vulnerable population, and we use the relatively small unit block group to define the vulnerable population. We have five different criteria. All of them are quoted from previous research. You either more than 20% household below poverty, this is the USDA definition, or more than 40% below double poverty, or more than 30% household without a car, or median family income at or below 80% of areas median family income, or we combined the poverty line and the car accessibility measurement. So this is our criteria about how to define vulnerable population. Okay, now we have all the tools. Now is to identify food desert. We generate service areas around different grocery stores, and we know how to measure vulnerable population. How do we define the food desert? We just need to intersect the vulnerable population area and the service areas. So using this, we will identify the block groups, which are within the King County Urban Growth Boundary, but outside of service areas. We define a designated their food desert. To give you a quick example, this is a low-income, low-car ownership block groups. We say this is a vulnerable population where they lived. Then we generate, we assume they will only go to low or median cost grocery store to buy food. But because they have no car, so we say, okay, let's see how far they can reach by 10 minutes of walking. So we generate 10 minutes of walking service area around low and median cost grocery store. This is a red area. So you just need to intersect about these two layers. You will identify how many of low-income and low-car ownership population are living outside 10-minute walking distance around the low and median cost of grocery stores. This is just an example how to identify food desert. Oh. So this is the final result about our identification of food desert. The first block is accessibility to all supermarkets. The second block is accessibility measure to low-cost grocery store. The third one is to median-cost grocery store. The last one is to high-cost grocery store. And each column is different physical accessibility measure or transportation measure. It's a 1 mile distance, 10 minutes walking, 10 minutes biking to driving. And this number are the population living outside of, okay, let's give you an example. This 24 is saying 24% of low income population whose neighborhood has more than 20% below poverty line. 24% of them are living outside of 1 mile distance to all supermarkets. So this is saying, okay, for the population below poverty line, more than 20% and 30% had no cars, 97% are living outside of 10 minutes walking distance to a low-cost supermarket. basically they're saying they cannot walk to a supermarket. Okay, same criteria for the low income and the no car population. 61% are living outside of 10 minute walking distance to a median house supermarket. And so 96% are living outside 10 minutes walking distance to a high cost of supermarket. So this is a breakdown of different measurement. So we can see when we switch our bars, how to measure accessibility and how to define vulnerable populations, the population living within the food desert changes. Conclusion. I just want to point some highlight. Up to 29% of vulnerable population lived 1 mile away from any supermarket. This is a USDA definition. 60% living 1 mile away of low or medium cost of supermarket. It's saying, okay, if you just look at their definition, 29%. But if you get rid of high cost of grocery store, actually the number increased. 45 to 66% of our vulnerable population were beyond a 10 minutes walking distance of any supermarket. Basically, it's saying most of them cannot walk to a supermarket to buy a grocery store. Again, the estimation of population living in food desert depends on how do we define vulnerable population and what accessibility measure are employed. So this is a short conclusion. If you are interested, this paper was published by American Journal of Public Health in 2010. So you can find this full text paper from this link. So you must ask as a planner, how do we divide, how do we remove the food desert? I just threw some ideas here. We can use land use or zoning policy to attract supermarkets to low-cost, low-income neighborhoods, or we can provide tax break, trying to keep existing grocery stores in low-income neighborhoods, because previous research showed for the minority low-income neighborhood, this existing grocery stores actually serve as an anchor point for that neighborhood, socially and economically. So we need provide some tax breaks to keep these grocery stores within their neighborhood. We can, of course, provide better transit service to low-cost, low-income, and low-car ownership neighborhood. Or we can maybe redesign community gardens or city parks for urban agriculture purpose. This is very popular in the Rust Belt cities. Most of them are located in the Midwest, like Detroit, Cleveland, Indianapolis. So this is just some rough idea about how do we, as a planner, remove food desert. So now it's question and suggestion. Thank you. Kelly?
Oh. Hi, Nick Foster. When you were looking at your transit distance,
yeah.
Did you consider a certain walking distance that people would walk to get to the bus stop for a buffer on the transit lines, or were you looking only at tracks along the transit
line? That's a very good question. This one is all only transit along the transit line. We are supposed to consider in the following research the distance from people's home walking to the transit stops, and also the frequency of the transit line, and the ridership along the transit line. But this one just pure buffer out distance. But that's a very good question.
Thank you.
I was wondering how some of your demographic played into your research, particularly how single family households as opposed to households with children, you know, you have the single person compared to maybe a single parent or the two parent household with small children. I mean, how did that impact your research at all? I mean, because I think that having children makes it a little bit tougher to get to the grocery store. I'm just curious your thoughts on that.
In terms of their travel behavior to grocery stores, having our children definitely affect their travel mode and the travel frequency to grocery stores. But in terms of pure accessibility to grocery stores, it doesn't make too much difference because we just measure what existing there. And the definition about the vulnerable populations didn't consider whether you are a single household or whether you have children within your household. The pure definition of vulnerable populations, your income level, and also some research will include whether you have a car accessibility or whether you have a college of education or whether you have you're a minority or not. So far the research haven't considered whether you have a children within the household or not, but that's a very good question. Maybe in the future research we can say, okay, if you're within the household, living low-income neighborhood also has children within their household, we can include that as a criteria for vulnerable population as well.
And are you looking at, when you speak about car ownership, are you looking at solely car ownership within the household, or are you referring to car accessibility, like somebody who has access to a motor vehicle, like zip car, something like that?
That data has come from the sensor. So within, that's saying how many percent of their household within that sensor track had accessibility to a car. So I assume that's only considered car, not considered a motor vehicle or other different motorized transportation mode. That answer your question?
Yes.
Hi. I was wondering if you're aware of this research being used at all for any advocacy efforts by anyone else, or if anyone has any plans to do so in King County?
That's a very good question. Actually, this research was, since it's published, has received a lot of media coverage from the King County News and the Seattle newspaper, and the NBC actually reported that research. And I recently found this research was quoted by the King County Department of Public Health when they define the food desert within the county. And it's good. So it brought us some attention to accessibility within the area. Yeah.
Thank you.
and I may have missed this. I think you said this was funded by the
NIH.
So is this research going to be used to change any of the definitions by the USDA to clarify, or is this just for research purposes?
So far, I haven't seen any change. USDA didn't reach out to me and include your definition of food desert in their criteria. But I hope they will look at this paper and maybe give some thought about that. I need to clarify this research. This is the principal investigator is Adam Jonaski, is a public health researcher at the University of Washington. My supervisor and Professor Anne Boudon is a co-PI. I work as a research assistant on this project. The whole project is called Seattle Obesity Study. The main purpose of that research is trying to see whether accessibility to food, to faster food, will affect your public health level in terms of obesity level, diabetes disease. And this is just a side work. Side research, I use the data for my dissertation purpose. Yep.
I was wondering if you could go back to the slide that had all of the data laid out. I think it was like one or two slides before that. Yeah, that one. Yeah, I thought it was interesting, the low-cost supermarkets where it showed the 97% below poverty line, but then just the who couldn't walk to a low-cost grocery store, but then just the general population is 94%. So it's also still very high, just not just for the disadvantaged, but just in general. So I thought that was kind of interesting. And in terms of your suggestions, you had said maybe, you know, community gardens would be one option, and it seems like this data really supports some of those more localized options just in general. You know, I'm not an expert on, like, the economics of grocery stores, but I know that, you know, it's not easy to have tons of grocery stores, you know, sprinkled throughout the city just because they require a large population to support. So it seems like some of those smaller scale options would address some of that.
Definitely provide or allow small size grocery store within the community will help us solve this food desert problem. Also, have a community garden will help us. Here we have a lot. Professor Kelly Clifton did a good research about the travel to grocery stores. According to her research, if you have a local size grocery store, it promotes local shopping and it's encouraged local economics. So definitely have a small size grocery store within the community will benefit the community socially and economically. Yep.
I think along those lines, especially in public health, we've been looking at the development of the healthy corner store, so which I'm sure you're aware of, but so getting funding to those stores for adequate refrigeration, other things, so they can have the more healthy options.
Fresh food.
And be more of that, because the development of major grocery store and getting them into the community seemed to be something that, you know, has historically been very difficult.
Yeah, that's a very good suggestion, and I know they have been working on that, trying to transform corner store to healthy corner stores, as you said, provide a refrigerator to keep their food fresh and so on. So yes, definitely there's some movement going on. It's a good movement. Kelly.
Thank you for this work. It's great to see the food systems planning and food access and food security work take hold in planning and transportation. My research was quite a while ago, and I remember people weren't used to the words food security or food desert in my dissertation, so now I'm glad that they're part of the vernacular. When you, so one of the things I'm interested in these improved measures, and I do think they go a long way to helping to identify populations that are vulnerable and locations that are food deserts, do you see that with these improved measures, you see improved correlations then with health outcome data that you would get from on a broad scale? Do you see an improved association and models looking at health outcome?
That's a very good question. Actually, I'm currently trying to use a special statistics and trying to see whether you already identified the people, vulnerable population living within the food desert. I also have their public health stats. So I try to use the statistics to see whether you live at a food desert has any relationship to your public health status. So far, I just run the after control your SES and see whether your location has any impact or relationship to your public health status. So far, I just run the obesity level correlation. So actually, the research is saying, the result is showing there's a modest effect. You're living in a food desert as a positive correlation to the obesity level in these metropolitan areas after control your social income level and other SES variables. I haven't got a chance to look at the relationship between your location and the diabetes and the chronic disease, but for obesity, there's a modest positive correlation about living in the food desert and you have high obese level.
Yeah, so one of the things that I'm interested to, I mean, I think it would be valuable for you to demonstrate that this is a much more robust measurement of food deserts, to test it with the old criterion and then test it with your new criterion to show that you get a much stronger correlation with the new metrics.
Yeah, thank you. That's a very good suggestion. Thank you, Kelly.
I wonder how businesses locate their supermarkets in the area. What their criteria is how to locate supermarkets?
You mean the how their business owner locate their supermarket?
Yeah, yeah.
So I can show you. Basically, for the low and the median cost supermarket, they locate everywhere. They are roughly evenly distributed. But for the high cost, they only locate at the high income neighborhood. Like this is a high income neighborhood. This is most of them you can see. Actually, you can see it's quite interesting. Most of them are along the sea water line. So you can guess they are high income neighborhood by the water area. So when Whole Foods decide where to locate their next grocery store, they will do a research about the income level within that potential neighborhood, and they will pick up the high income neighborhood. This is at least what I'm thinking they were located there, supermarkets. Yep.
I don't think it's really a question, but I used to live up in Seattle, and I think topographically you have a lot of issues when you get further away from the water. I mean, you have shoreline issues, obviously, but then, like, you know, Seattle is really hilly. There's a lot of environmental problems with development, and almost all the stores you quoted are really big box stores, so they require a lot of space and a lot of environmental review. So that's kind of something that I would really like to see in the planning and permitting world, is to kind of open up the process to allow smaller stores, and it really, you know, drives a change in the store's development as well, to adapt to that, so that it's easier and less expensive to go into more neighborhoods.
That's very true. Now the local side, the small grocery store find themselves have a hard time to compete with the big box because their cost-benefit analysis. So as a planner or policymaker, we probably can provide some tax break to this small size grocery store and trying to keep them or trying to move them to the neighborhood. So as you said, we have a better accessibility to grocery store by introducing them in the neighborhood.
I think just to follow up with that, I think there's some interesting things about when you think about the goods that people are buying at a grocery store. So if you're buying the things that you want people to have access to are the green grocery things, so your produce and those types of things, meats and vegetables that are healthy. But we know that people buy other things at supermarkets now, right? So you have toiletries and other household goods. Yeah. And so these big box retailers are starting to offer, and they're competing with these grocery stores because they're offering everything at a lower price. And so in some sense, if you are operating on a very low income, it does make sense to pull your funds and find a ride to one of these big box retailers to buy sort of dry goods, if you will. So in some sense, you could think about changing some of the economics so that the stores that are going into these locations are just focusing on, are just green grocers, right? Because you would want people to go to those more frequently because the goods themselves aren't going to keep.
Exactly.
Although that changes then the profit margin and the economics for that store. So most grocery stores make their money on sort of higher sort of unique goods. So they're not making it on bread and milk, they're making it on sort of pesto and gourmet cheese. It doesn't mean that they're not making profit on bread and milk, but the amount of market they have to serve and the number of customers that they have to sell changes that economics a little bit. So it's a complicated sort of policy question
Yes.
To sort of try to solve right out of the gate. But from a transportation standpoint, so even if the landscape of options aren't changing, we could think about changing the way these stores service those areas. And one of those could be, instead of always providing transportation for the customer to go to the store, you could think about delivery options so that the stores are, you know, we think about how community-supported agriculture now delivers a box of goods to your door. You could think about something like that in these locations that may, in the end, in terms of public subsidy to economic development, provide more bang for the buck than subsidizing a store where the economics just really aren't working. But I don't think we've fully sort of explored all of the options that are there for people.
Thanks, Kelly. That's a very good comment. Actually, when I did this research, you know, Amazon Fresh is online grocery shopping. So we have some thought. Should we include Amazon Fresh in this accessibility measurement? But after some debate, we didn't include Amazon Fresh because the scale is, to make it simple, we have five students in the lab. Only three students heard of Amazon Fresh. So their scale is not that big. So we decided to not include Amazon Fresh online grocery shopping here. But in the future, definitely online grocery shopping or delivery service can help us from a transportation perspective solve the accessibility or improve accessibility to fresh food. Yeah.
Assuming people have access to the internet.
Yes.
Just another comment that made me think when you were talking, it may be interesting to add like farmers market access to the study. I know like in Portland, for example, there are many small markets in almost every neighborhood at this point. So that could be interesting.
Yeah, definitely having a farmers market or local grocery store will improve locals' accessibility to fresh and green vegetables and healthy food. Yeah.
Okay, I have one question online from Karen. Her question is, were informal off-street path considered in the walking distance calculation or just... Whether informal off-street path has been considered distance calculation.
No, unfortunately, the data didn't include a shortcut of the within the backyard, so we didn't include informal walk short paths to calculate the walking distance. But that's a very good question. Maybe if had we have a more detailed data about the sidewalk and the short path, I will include that as a walking distance measurement as well.
He also has another question regarding how change in car ownership and growth of bike or biking culture may impact a study or similar study in the future.
Oh, yeah, that's a very good question. So aside the research related to this one, should 88% of people living in Seattle metropolitan area driving to buy the grocery store? 12% actually use other different transportation mode. But a significant chunk within this 12% transit and working. Biking is not that high percentage within the 12%, but I suspect the biking culture will change the people to transportation to mode, the transportation mode to grocery store in the long run. Maybe a lot of people will just bike to grocery store to buy groceries. I have some observation. I saw we don't have a box in front of a bicycle. We always see this kind of bicycle in Europe, so they can put the food or things within that box. But here, the bike just has a two bag in the back. Look like a racing bike, not like a domestic use bike. So maybe the manufacturer will change a little bit. Maybe put some box or some carry-on storage place on the bicycle. So that will change people's transportation mode in the long run.
I'm so interested in the topic. Okay. So I may have missed this in the beginning, but in your definition of, so you were just looking at supermarkets.
Yes.
So you weren't looking at other types of food retailers like bodegas and things like that you would see in neighborhoods like White Center that tend to have a high immigrant population.
Yeah. So this one, just supermarkets. The small grocery stores, even large grocery stores, not included in this service, just supermarkets. Super.
Yeah. So I think that's a cultural issue to think about as well, because when we go to other countries, the ways of shopping and the preferred sort of store environments are different than sort of what we think of as sort of the American norm that we go to a big supermarket. Although I would say here in Portland, it's probably a little unusual compared to the rest of the U.S., but, you know, people going to a bakery, people going to a greengrocer, people going to a butcher, and we still see that culture in a lot of low-income communities that would weigh in as food deserts, but in reality may have better access to healthy foods than higher-income places.
That's true. I support that argument. So if you're living in a minority neighborhood, you have a very robust corner store, the small grocery store, you might have a better access to healthy food than the low-income neighborhood, which just go to the high-cost grocery store to buy groceries. So again, the definition of a USDS food desert definition is very limited, so we can see we can improve it in the long run.
Because probably it related to what Kelly just brought up, online question kind of, have you surveyed a sample of the vulnerable population vulnerable population to compare your study's prediction to actual data?
We have surveyed 2001 general respondent within the King County areas, and using our definition of vulnerable population, around 250 of them are classified of vulnerable population. This number changed according to how do you define the vulnerable population. In the survey, we include your social demographic information, your public health information, and your transportation mode to school and to other facilities. But because of the survey, it's not focused on food desert. We didn't ask how do you feel living in a food desert, or do you feel difficulty living in your neighborhood? So, but there's definitely some information left in the survey. We can see there, as I said before, their public health status, their obesity level, and we can run analysis between their location and your obesity level. I would like to run independent survey to see, just to focus on the resident living in the food desert and see how they feel about living in their neighborhood. Maybe they never thought about living in the food desert. They would say, oh, I'm perfectly okay and I live happily. I have a good access to everything. So I don't think I'm living in the food desert. That would be interesting to know as well. So yeah, this is in my to-do list.
So I think, you know, this, like any other health behavior, is really complicated, right? So just because you live with great access to healthy food doesn't mean that you're going to take advantage of that. And even if you purchase healthy food, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to prepare it in a healthy way.
Yes.
And then you may live in a food desert and go to great lengths to access healthy food, but there's a trade-off there that might not come up in these kinds of surveys. So, you know, expending a lot of time or expending a lot of extra money then has a consequence somewhere else. It's very complicated to sort of see these kinds of results that people are asking, but I do think that this kind of work is just going to get better and better in terms of our ability to really understand how people are responding to the environment. But so even asking questions about, you know, their behaviors, it's
it's going to take a lot more to really understand the full-on implications of it.
Yes, definitely.
Thank you.